This afternoon, we're going to kick off with an inspiring session about diversity, equity, and inclusion, and how D&I impacts aviation, and what's the impact of aviation with D&I on the world. So aviation is a unique bridge between cultures, we know that, and give it a special role in championing DE&I, both within its workforce and in the diverse communities it serves around. So D&I is what brought us together in the first place, because when we started 25 by 2025, we were speaking about gender imbalance in the industry, but we also took a broader view on what's D&I and why it's important and why it's critical to address it as in the broader people agenda. So together, we'll uncover how the industry can make a lasting impact through DE&I. So our first speaker for this session is Adrian Binfield. So Adrian is the head of people and culture at IAG. And for those who are not aware, British Airways, which is part of IAG, are our latest winners of the IATA D&I Team Award in 2024. So you may have seen on the screens during the lunch break, we had the interviews of our latest DE&I winners, and we had some representatives of British Airways. So Adrian is going to talk about his experience at IAG, what they're doing in the field of diversity, equity, and inclusion, making sure that they have a lasting impact, and including focusing on the importance of leadership when it comes to DE&I. So Adrian, I would like to welcome you on the stage.
You set the bar by saying it's going to be an inspiring speech, so I'm hopefully I'll deliver on at least some of that in the next 10 minutes or so. So hopefully you've had a great lunch, but you haven't indulged too much on the cake and the sugar rush kind of drops off in about 5 minutes' time. I'll notice a few nodding heads if we do. So first of all, I think I'd just like to say a massive thank you to Jane and David and the IATA team for hosting today. I think it's such an important opportunity for us all to come together as a community. Everyone I've spoken to so far, and that's only about 10% of the audience, have shared stories with me already that resonate massively with what we've been faced with within IAG. So I don't think I'm going to share with you any kind of silver bullets or any fast-track ways of implementing D&I and getting it embedded within our business. But hopefully some of the things that we talk about today will resonate, and there'll be things that you can build on in your business, or you've got ideas of how I can do my job better than I'm doing it today. So I was going to talk a little bit about IAG's journey. I've been in the role for 3 years. I'm a complete newbie to the aviation world, so I'm still learning four-letter acronyms every day that I'm here. I joined with naive optimism based on a conversation with Carolina Martinoli, who was my boss at the time, and with Luis Gallego, the CEO of the group. They passionately believe that for IAG, talent is the single biggest synergy that we've got in the group. It's quite a unique group. We're made up of a number of airlines, as you can see on the chart here. So we've got some, you know, national flag carriers like BA, Iberia, and Aer Lingus. We've got some low-cost operators like Iberia Express and Vueling. At Level, we've got the loyalty business, which is Avios. And then we've got a cargo business, which is one of our platform businesses that goes across. And all of those operating companies are independent. So the role of IAG is more of a holding company. We decide where to invest our capital to deliver the best returns for our shareholders. But we also have a role to play in setting frameworks and policies and expectations that we think that the airlines need to work towards. And that's where my role comes in. I was it's a brand new role that was created by Luis, and he asked me to come in and to drive the talent, the culture, the D&I agenda across the group. Leadership plays an absolutely critical part of all of that, and linked to that is reward. So I've got, you know, the joy of working on all of the really interesting and transformational parts of the role. I also am I'm grateful that the people directors in the airlines get to deal with the industrial relations challenges and some of the resourcing and recruitment challenges that were kind of a bit of a backdrop to the world that I moved into in 2021. So what I wanted to spend a few minutes around is just kind of what did I find when I came into the business, and what have we done? And I'm going to focus on two areas. One is around senior leadership and how we've shifted the dial around the diversity of our senior leaders. And the second one is more of a work in progress, which is where are we in terms of pilots and the diversity of our pilots. And as I said, no silver bullets. And please come up to me afterwards and share any great insights or breakthroughs that you might have. So what did I find? So first of all, I think the opcos are brilliant businesses. You know, they're really well-recognized brands. We find it relatively easy to attract people into the business. I think the brands are well recognized in their markets. They've got a good value set associated with them. And we've got an incredibly diverse business. So when you look at our cabin crew and our ground operations, you look in our customer service environment and you look in our corporate teams, you can see, you know, the communities that we live and work in. But we know there are a couple of pockets where we haven't made that breakthrough, both in senior leadership and particularly in our pilot population. I found an aspiration to do something about it, and I think aspiration is probably the right phrase to use, because we didn't really have a plan. We didn't really know how we were going to deliver on where we wanted to get to. We didn't know how difficult or easy it was going to be and where we needed to place our efforts. We had very disparate HR systems. So we had a great presentation earlier around data. Marta, who's in my team, will know and still knows to this day the challenges that we have in just counting the number of senior leaders we've got in our business, let alone understanding what how they identify or their profile. So reporting becomes quite challenging in that environment. We had a model around talent, which I'd probably best describe as patronage. We knew who we knew. So quite often when we would make a senior appointment, that individual would go into their role and say, I need to drive change, I need to bring in some new people, I need folks that I can trust to help me drive that change. And typically, they brought some or most of the team that they'd worked with before and grown up in their careers with. And that meant that was a real barrier for us being able to bring new ideas and new people in with different experiences to come into our business. Careers were mostly vertical. So you either joined into one of the airlines and one of the functions and you worked your way up vertically until you got to a point where, you know, that breadth of experience became a bit of a barrier to further progression. Mobility was not something that we actively promoted across the business or that we had policies and processes in place that really underpinned it. And when you look at the reward that we've got, each of the airlines sets its own terms and conditions. And so we had some real challenges around supporting that mobility from a reward perspective, because people would, you know, lose out on certain benefits. Most emotive, of course, were flight benefits, but there were other things associated with pension rates being different or pay structures being set differently, etc. So a relatively difficult environment to start one, but I think with a real passion from the senior leadership team to do something about it. And what I wanted to share is how we have made progress from a senior leadership perspective. We were bouncing around the 30% mark. So we describe our senior leaders as the top two levels in the organization. It's about 200 leaders in total. We were at 30% in 2021. I think we were at 32% in 2019. We were at 30% in 2018. So we were just bouncing along because I don't think we really had that plan, that real focus and attention on how to drive change. Today, we're at 37% and we are on track towards our ambition of getting to 40% by 2025. So that's real progress. It comes down to, if I'm honest, hard work, persistence, keeping in front of mind with the senior leaders so that we don't forget. And it's not that diversity is an and statement. I want to get a great person and wouldn't it be amazing if. But it needs to be part of that whole thinking about understanding the nature of the roles that we're recruiting for, breaking down some of the perceptions that we might have about people that have the capability to do the role. Quite often we would talk about somebody must have done all of these things before. Well, most of the time people haven't done all of those things before. We're assessing their underlying capability to do the job. So the first challenge I think we faced was about getting a commitment to a level of ambition. And that was quite tough. We've made that ambition and we've made it a public statement. So it's in all of our annual reports and we're tracking and reporting against it on a quarterly basis now. But we had to show, using the data, that this was something that was realistic and achievable. So looking at the attrition rates that we could see, looking at the levels of churn in roles that we've got, looking at what our appointment rates are, looking at what we've got coming up through the organisation in terms of talent and the profile of that talent, and showing that, you know, in reality, this is relatively small incremental change that needs to be delivered to get from the 30% to the 40%. So, for example, to get from 37 to 40 is 9 roles for us, right? So it really is every single appointment that we make makes a difference towards or away from our diversity targets. So that was quite tough, giving us the confidence to sign up to that level of commitment. Next up for us was around accountability. So each of our airlines have got their own target or ambition that they're working towards. And they report to us in group how they're progressing towards those. They give a forecast of where they think they're getting to. They talk through where they are, where they're not on track, and what action they're taking to address it. And that's really important, that it isn't HR that own that target. It is leaders and managers within the business. And they've done it in a number of the airlines. They've taken it down a couple of levels where the size of their senior teams is sufficient for us to set a meaningful target. I've talked about data and the importance of data and really understanding what's driving any change. So, for example, we've seen where we make direct appointments. And there's always, I think if we're just being pragmatic, there are always times when we have an urgent need to fill a vacancy or where there genuinely is only one candidate for a particular role. But we know that when we make a direct appointment, we're only about 20 to 25% of the time appointing a woman into that role. We know that when we go to the external market, go through a full benchmarking exercise, open the vacancy up to internal candidates, we get to around about 45% of candidates and then appointments that are women. So there's a real challenge for us in challenging the senior leaders to think about and stick to a process which is about transparency and openness. We've done a lot around succession planning. So I think when I arrived, succession planning was a once a year, once and done exercise, filling in some spreadsheets and then, you know, looking at it and saying that's interesting, and then putting it back in the drawer for a year. You know, that has evolved, I think, to where it becomes something that is a live process. And we've now got the people directors, when they've got vacancies, saying, can you share with us who the talent are for this role, for this function, that you think could be a great candidate for us to consider? And that's a massive shift for us, but it's not getting us where we need to yet, because, you know, we're not doing enough, in my view, around career planning that says, well, that individual might be a potential candidate in 3 years from now, or 2 years, or 1 year from, but what do they need to demonstrate in the next year? What experience do we need to give them? What access to other sponsors or leaders in the business to close the gap between their level of readiness today and their level of readiness in a year's time? And similar to the appointments, we've got about 45% of our talent and our pipelines of talent that are women. So we've got really good, strong confidence that we've got great women leaders coming up through the business that will get into those senior roles in time. Final bit for me is around culture and, you know, the role that leaders play in building that culture and being inclusive. And I talk to too many people who feel that their voice isn't heard within the business. And that's not just women. There are others, underrepresented groups, who will say that they just don't feel there's a dominant voice in the room. And if we don't tackle that as leaders and we don't create a more inclusive environment that does give different voices, different opinions, different perspectives a chance to be heard, then I think we're going to really struggle to deliver on the change in our senior leaders. What's next for us in our senior leadership diversity strategy are two things. First of all, we define senior leaders as the top 200, roughly the top 200 leaders in our organisation. Increasingly external reporting. So we in the UK, as a FTSE business, we have to report and we have to report against MC and direct reports for MC, which is a smaller population for us. That's about 90 of those 200 roles. And we're only at about 30% for those roles. So whilst our broader leadership population, we're at 37%, we know for those most senior executive positions that we're at a lower position, and that's a big challenge for us going forward. Delighted that we've got two female CEOs for the airlines. That's an incredible thing, and we're really proud of that. And they're both fantastic leaders, and having them there demonstrates what the opportunities are for all. But we know we've got to do more in that very senior executive space. The second thing for us was around beyond gender. Now, we selected gender because we had the data in varying degrees of quality, and we were reporting on it already. And it was a really visible sign of commitment to change for us as a business. But we know that gender means so much more. Diversity means so much more than gender. Our challenge was we just don't know what the profile of our senior leaders was. Right? We operate mostly in Spain, the UK, and Ireland. And the challenges we faced in understanding the profile of our leaders was, you know, language and terminology means different things in different jurisdictions. So, you know, I learned a lot about the difference between a UK view of race and ethnicity and a Spanish view of nationality and national heritage. And it's very easy to go in with your size 11 boots on and say, we're going to apply one size fits all approach. But actually, that becomes more divisive than it does become inclusive. So we've had to think very carefully about what we ask our senior leaders and what we report and how we do that differently, respecting the different societal and regulatory context in each of the countries we operate in. We know we have some issues around GDPR, so data protection regulation in Europe. And we know we've got some issues around trust with our senior leaders, for them to be able to disclose and share with us things that they don't necessarily share with their work colleagues or feel comfortable or don't feel comfortable about how that data is going to be used and treated within the business. But I'm delighted that we managed to get a survey our senior leaders done last year, and we had an 88% response rate, which I think is exceptional. I think it's quite a lot higher than we would have expected to do. We were kind of thinking it might be 60, 70%. And actually, when we completed that survey, there were some real surprises and insights for us. So, for example, 50% of our senior leaders were first generation in their families to go to university. So when we want to talk to colleagues around social mobility, that's a really important data point to say our leadership includes loads of people that have overcome barriers, etc., to get where they are today. 6% declared as being identified as neurodiverse, which I think is higher than the national average in the three countries that we've got. So, you know, again, when we're talking to colleagues that might be neurodiverse and thinking about, you know, what future and opportunities are there for me within IAG, knowing that our senior leaders are represented by that community is really important. 50% have caring responsibility for either children or elderly relatives, and that was the same for men and women respondents. And 30% said they had an associate diversity, so they had somebody in their family that was identified for one of the underrepresented groups that we were surveying around. So for me, that next step of how do we use that understanding of the differences amongst our senior leaders to show that diversity and difference are really important and something that we value, that's the next big step for us. The other thing for me is around pilots. So senior leaders was kind of the first big challenge for me in the role and for us as a team. But the next big challenge for us is around our pilot community. I genuinely feel this is a once in a generation opportunity for us as a business. Those kind of things don't come along very often to make a real difference where we can look back in 10 or 15 years' time and say we've left a real legacy behind. But you know, we haven't made the progress, if we're honest, as a business and as an industry on the diversity of our pilots. So on the left-hand side, you've got Lynn Barton. Lynn was the first female cadet to join BA. She was the first pilot to join BA. She was actually the first pilot to land at London Heathrow Terminal 5. She's got a career of firsts of being a pioneer from you know, the early 80s all the way through to when she retired in 2016. She had a dream of wanting to be a pilot. And I think one of the challenges that we've got in our industry is there's not enough young girls or women that consider that dream as something that is attainable or something that they would be interested and motivated by. And despite all of the investment we're all making in outreach programs and attraction opportunities, we're still not getting anywhere near the level of applications from women for our cadet programs or for our direct entry programs. So, you know, BA for its Speedbird cadet program had 100 vacancies on the program, 20,000 applicants, 15% were women. And that's a massive challenge for us. But on the other side, we know that in the next 10 years, about 3,000 of our pilots, so about a third of our pilot workforce, will retire. That's what we're forecasting. 97% of whom are men. So in the next 10 years, we will face some massive, massive recruitment shortfalls in that pilot community. And I'm sure you're all facing similar issues and challenges. We won't get there just with our cadet programs as they're structured today. We don't have the capacity to train that number of pilots through the cadet program. We don't have the currently the infrastructure to attract or to encourage the number of applications that we need to make a real difference from a gender perspective. Interestingly, all of our focus on advertising roles using traditional means, we weren't getting where we wanted to. The single biggest thing that made a difference to our applications in Aer Lingus was two female pilot cadets in Cadiz filming a TikTok video, and that generated thousands of applications within days. So we're having to rethink what do we do around attraction. We're also lifting the lid on every single part of our process. So, you know, we have a bunch of tests that we expect our future pilots to meet. One of those was around maths. The benchmark that we used historically was our existing pilots, most of whom were men in their 40s or above, typically with a science degree or background, engineering background. So we're benchmarking against a group that doesn't actually represent the needs and the role and the requirements of the role. So we've had to really look at some of the things around our policies and processes and how we go through that selection activity. And then thinking about retention, because keeping hold of the women pilots that we've got today is really critical. We know we haven't done a good enough job on supporting return to work after pregnancy. We've learned lots about things like having uniforms that are menopause friendly, using the right materials and the right fabrics and the right cut of those materials. We know that we need to think long and hard around some of our policies around schedules and rosters and whether they are, you know, as flexible as they can be. But we know, and this is, I get the bit for me, is we want to make a difference in the next 10 years. Whether that difference gets us to 10% or 25%, we're still doing the work on. But I don't think we feel like we would have done our jobs in IAG or in our HR team if we haven't shifted that dial at some point in the next 10 years. So hopefully some of that has resonated, sparked some ideas, but I'll hand back, I think, to David now. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Adrian, for this. So yeah, it's very interesting, and I think that we can't underestimate the role of having diverse representation in the leadership positions, because I mean, we always say you cannot be what you cannot see. So if you don't have a diverse representation in the top roles, you won't have the right pool of talents to come up these roles. So it's also interesting to see the struggle that you are having in reporting, and of course reporting on data, gathering data, is something very different, and from a jurisdiction to another you cannot report on the same things. Some jurisdiction forbids to report on some aspects of diversity, but it's also very important to continue to measure what you can, because this is how you bring accountability, is by measuring and seeing the progress that you can make. So thank you again, Adrian, for your insights. Our next speakers are Rachel Douglas and Adele Johnson. So Rachel is Organizational Behavior Manager at Dinata, and Adele is Dinata's HR Director for the UK. So Dinata has a very unique and fantastic programs to empower women and work on the ground to integrate DEI, and especially in the field offices. So thank you for coming, Rachel and Adele.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Am I online? I can be heard. Thank you very much for welcoming us. Adele and I are going to tag team today because we both work in different markets. I have a global role in Dubai, and I've lived there for the last 26 years, which is, I guess, the start of my love of the journey of culture and diversity and inclusion. So I'm just going to allow Adele just to introduce herself before I take the floor and we tag team our presentation.
Is it relevant to say hello? If you get it, you get it. Adele, yeah. Thank you. UK HR director, looking after nearly 3,000 employees in the ground handling, or I like to call them unsung heroes or unseen heroes in the UK market. Thank you.
Thanks, Adele. So just a bit of context you might be familiar with, Dinata. We're a global organisation, over 50,000 employees, four diverse business areas across 30 countries. And like all of you in the room, you know, we are striving towards the ESG agenda, the 70 material issues, so we can make that difference and be part of that solution. We know that there's many diverse groups that we focus on across the globe. Today, we're going to share a couple of case studies around the gender element. We are also embarking on various initiatives around disability, socioeconomic, race, ethnicity, intergenerational. But today, we wanted to just take a little deeper dive into the gender side of our diverse groups. Now, I'm stolen from AIHR just to kind of give a bit of a framework. Obviously, you can see that I'm a very visual person. And I think it just gives us, I guess, just sort of compartmentalize the different elements that we try to look at to have that cultural transformation. You know, starting with the results, actually, what would the measurement of success be? How do we articulate that? What are our processes that support that? What are the management systems that we have in place? What sort of leadership behaviours do we aspire for, and what sort of change and learning opportunities that we aim to promote with our females? We're not perfect. We're not there 100% where we need to be, but we are, you know, making our best efforts to be able to enhance and improve our leadership capability for females. When we think about the result, I always think about the measure of success first of all, and that is holding our leadership to account. We are currently at 28% globally of our females in leadership roles, and we have a stretch target from our CEO to go to 30% by the end of 2025. The people insights data is very important to us to be able to make those decisions on where we are now, where we aspire to be. Setting those KPI targets, but also as well measuring the engagement of our and the sentiment of our employees and the sense of them feeling like they belong. The other element is on the processes, having inclusive policies, you know, parental friendly policies, those flexible working policies. We have a major focus and a proactive focus on female wellbeing. And my colleague Adele is going to share a case study from the UK and more insights in terms of how we do that. And although I'm based in the UAE and Adele's based in the UK, we do a massive collaboration around the globe where we leverage off each other's tools and resources. From a collaboration perspective, technology is obviously, you know, investment for us is, you know, in a very male-dominated industry. And we're operational workers. Then the technology or the changes in technology is enabling more females to take on operational roles than they were before. Management systems, obviously, across the employee life cycle, you know, from how we recruit our hiring practices, you know, our recruitment skills training for our managers as well to take out those unconscious biases, our performance management, the metrics and data collection, having the right employee resource groups that will build the camaraderie and the confidence of the females, as well as the external partnerships. Leadership is obviously a critical one for us, and this is, you know, that sort of buy-in, that commitment, that accountability, the role modeling and the inclusive leadership behaviours are critical for our success, and that shows up in the decision-making every day. So just in terms of the changes in learning, which is, I guess, the first level of the pyramid, you know, for us, our in order to build that pipeline for our females to get us from the 28% to the 30% in leadership roles. Some of the courses and some of the initiatives that we've been doing is unconscious bias and inclusive leadership training globally. You know, we recognise that the demographics in every single country are different, some similarities, some differences, but there's legal, ethical, social, regulatory frameworks as well that we have to adjust in every single market that we go to and over those, you know, those 30 countries. So unconscious bias is something that we've rolled out and face-to-face with our leadership team so we can make that systemic change. Another programme, if you're not familiar with, is I'm Remarkable. Has anybody heard of I'm Remarkable? Amazing. Yes, we've got a few fans in the room. I've got the link to I'm Remarkable. It was actually created by a lady called Anne Viner for Google in around 2016. And it's actually not just for females, but it's also for marginalised groups. And it's a real social movement. And it's something that we brought into the organisation. And now we have 20 trainers that are there internally sharing that messages as well. And it really helps with the you know, the confidence and self-esteem around the biases for those marginalised groups. So that's also been an excellent one that I would highly recommend from a you know, from an activity perspective. We've had a lot of success with career development workshops and personal development planning, which is really about signposting. I think sometimes in the day-to-day, we become overwhelmed by all of the resources that are available. And this session is about giving them the opportunity to signpost what the resources are available, what are the knowledge and the skills that they might need, what is the personal development plan, how can they prepare and structure their development using the 70-20-10 approach. And this one has been very successful to be able to allow the females to come back in the room and zoom in and zoom out. We also do some career coaching within those sessions as well to give them that opportunity to get that insight and also that clarity on where they want to go. Leadership skills and obviously skills building. One of the other things that we are bringing in this year is maternity coaching. I know Adrian mentioned before around that return to work. You know, I've had three children during my career, and I think obviously it's a really critical you know, life event, you know, and this maternity coaching gives our females coaching before, during and after maternity leave, because this is a life-changing event as well, and it's autonomous if they want to embark and participate in that, but it really helps them to build that confidence and clarity. You often feel you come back from maternity leave and you're trying to carve your way back into your career. You feel out of sight and out of mind, so this is a really important one that we're going to facilitate this year. Mentorship has been ongoing for a while, and also the leadership forums have been a key thing. Now, obviously, you know, in a global role as well, you know, we operate in various geographies, and, you know, the markets and the cultures are different and we have to go at their pace. But we had a case study or an example of an event that we did in Tanzania, and the business issue, the managing director articulated that, you know, we've got 100 females that are super talented workers. But when it comes to applying for roles in the business or promotions or making that step change, they perceive that that's not for them and it's for the males in the operation. So, you know, my ask was, well, what is it, you know, what is it that you want to drive? What is it that you want to change? He said, I want to recognise the females. I want to give them the confidence. I want them to be able to grow in the organisation. I want them to apply for those roles. And that's when we designed, customised something which was leadership commitment, which was around career development planning. I am Remarkable, and also recognition ceremonies. You know, for me, you know, I was also asking, you know, a few months later, what is the impact of that? You know, what is the impact since that time? And there has been a mindset shift, a confidence, a performance, usage of training. And now we've seen that five of those individuals are really hungry to progress their careers and five of them have been promoted. But I think these things are important to go at their pace, not our pace. And really, we were able to give them the empowerment and encouragement to be able to move forward. So that's kind of a little bit. I'm going to hand over to Adele, who's going to share some examples in the UK market, which are, you know, and in terms of the wellbeing initiatives and so on.
Thank you. Thanks. I need notes. Rachel doesn't. Point to Rachel, not me. So thank you. So Donata UK, so there's some stats on the side there which I won't run through because a lot of these have been spoken about today already and I think we all understand, hence why we're here, the importance of the topic. But looking at our own stats,
you can see there were a 27.2% split for females across the business. However, at exco level, which is where I sit, 83% women, which is great, but pressure, okay? So pressure to do better. So that's what we're here for. So we're here to, this is just an example of how we measure gender, age, and also, most importantly, the leaver rate, because we talk a lot about attraction, but how do we retain? We get them in, we say, oh, this is a great place to work, we'll make it really good for you, et cetera, et cetera. And then there's this leaky bucket of women leaving. And actually, didn't believe that that could be possible in my business because we are female-focused and run by women. And it's true. Our leaver rate for females was far higher than our leaver rate for males. So for me, it was, if I can't get it right, I need to do better. So there's a focus on that for us here. Now, let's talk about it. This is a safe space. We were talking about this earlier. We need to reiterate, this is a safe space. So we're going to talk about menopause and why it's important to invest. So we've, Anton, you mentioned earlier, actually, that it's good to talk about things, but it also makes business sense. And this makes business sense. So just some of these elements here you can have a look at. But again, the last point there, 1 in 10 have left their jobs. Why do we do that? They've lost confidence, they've lost motivation, etc. And if we look at then the impact for me on the UK, this is my age split. So this is, you can see there, I've got 55.89% between the 30 and 49 grouping. So for me, it's really important that we're concentrating on how we ensure people feel safe and psychologically safe to talk about these issues at work. So if we just look at some of the points there, business sense, we've had 216 days of sickness. That's a stat that I'm happy to share with you due to gynecological issues. Now, they're just the ones that people are okay to report. That number might be far higher. So really, if we look at it from a business perspective, how do I make sure those people don't need to have those days off, or that we can support them during work, or that their sickness absence is reduced? So there's the business case there for that. And if we're really diverse and we really want to blow our minds, it won't be only those that identify as women that will be going through menopause. Let's think about that, okay? So the conversation might be harder to have. So let's also think about that. And if we look at diversity data, the BAME community, so females from the BAME community actually experience those symptoms on average 7 years earlier. So people that may have absence thinking that, oh, it can't be me, it can't be this now, it may well be. So it is important for us to start thinking about that. So just quickly on some of the things that we're doing in the UK, we're looking at implementing, obviously, a policy, but actually I'm changing this to a guideline because I think it's policy is too rigid, guidelines can flex, they can be adaptable, you can work with your employees on that. We're training line managers in terms of how to have those conversations, how to support people, obviously offering reasonable adjustments where possible, but really it's around the change in the workplace culture. We're looking at celebrating every year World Menopause Day, and we're going to do a big event this year called M&M, Menstrual Health to Menopause, where we're getting more people to just talk through some of the symptoms and things they have. Now, when we talk about attracting women into aviation, and Adrian, you touched on it earlier around uniform, some of those small things that don't retain you are just uncomfortable. You're just uncomfortable at that time. You know, your clothing's not right, your uniform's not flattering, it doesn't give any give, it's tailored, etc. So having a look at breathable fabrics, elastic waistbands, all those sorts of things. Period pads, I'm going to say it, you know, on a roll in the toilet so that you don't have to come out and then try and change and so on and so forth. And I have had staff go home because, yeah. And so we look at the honesty box for uniform. So let's just see how we can support what's very natural and make sure people feel okay with still being in work during that time in their life. Now, the last point I want to make on why it's important, why it makes business sense, is the empty nesters. Do we understand what empty nesters are? Yeah. So your kids have left. You were probably a stay-at-home mum. They've all gone. You're sitting there. What do I do? There's no one to look after. There's nothing for me to do. And actually, I wish I'd pursued my career in. And they're the biggest demographic in the UK for returning to work. Also, the divorce rate for over 50s is the highest. Therefore, financial independence again. I'm divorced. I need to find a job. I need to support myself in my new accommodation or my children, etc. They go back to work and they're going through this change in their life. So really, if these are the people that you're likely to most attract, these are the people that you really should be supporting. So thank you. I know it's a tough subject, but one we really should be thinking about more, especially in our industry. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for both of you. And this is indeed a tough topic to talk about, but I think that it's really important to talk about those topics because this is how we really drive the systemic change that we're all looking for and that it's much needed in our industry. So talking about creating a safe space to discuss things, we're going to now move to the table discussions. So as we were saying earlier, this event is a forum, and we want you to exchange ideas, exchange your views, your perspective, your challenges. So we are now going to go into the table discussions for about 15 minutes. We will give you two questions to discuss, so you can either cover both questions or just one of those as you wish. And the tricky thing is that at the end of the table discussion, we're going to ask you to designate someone at your table, take a phone, record a 30-second video and send it to UA. So by scanning the QR code that is on the screen here, you will access to UA's WhatsApp and you will send her your video so we can have an insight of what's being discussed during your discussions. So the two questions that we are going to discuss is, the first one is, how can airlines effectively build a strong employer brand and engage with potential candidates? And what is the role for social media and new digital channels? And the second one is, what can we do collectively to make sure the industry, to make the industry more attractive to people working in other industries and the new generation? So again, this is a safe space. So even if you see some people filming, nothing will be recorded. So you can discuss anything you want, share your views candidly, learn from others, and do enjoy your discussions. And we will remind you when it's time to designate someone and record the video. So thank you and enjoy the discussion. So everyone, this is just to remind you that it's now time to designate someone and record your 30-second video. So just mention the emerging themes that come up of your conversation. So you can designate someone at your table, grab a phone and record a 30-second video, just mentioning the themes that came up. Thank you. And then you send it to UA. Okay, so for those of you who have recorded your video, you just need to scan the QR code right here and send your video to UA. Thank you. So just so you know, those videos, we are not going to play them on screen. It's just to get the transcript from it and have the emerging themes. So don't be shy. We're not going to put up your face on the screens. Don't worry about that. Okay, so now I see that most of the phones are down. So if you have not done it yet, please scan the QR code and send your video to UA. Thank you all for your great contributions during the table discussions. We're going to use your insights to feed in the conversation in the next part. So I would like now to welcome our next speaker. Our next speaker is Aisima Gibbs. Aisima is Vice President CSR and DE&I at JetBlue, and she has spent the last 25 years, I think, in the company. She will share her views from a US perspective, which is quite interesting at the moment, because we know that DE&I has been challenged in the region, and Aisima is going to tell us how they did to keep it on the table. So thank you, Aisima.
So we'll talk to Jane and David later about the after-lunch slot that we got. Hopefully you're all awake, alive, alert, awake, and aware, and enthusiastic. Oh, that is not the first slide. We'll find it. Hold on. That's not it either. I'm missing a few slides. It's okay. So my name is Aisima Gibbs. I am the Vice President of Corporate Social Responsibility and Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion for JetBlue. I've been with JetBlue for 25 years. I know I don't look it. that's before we had planes, and literally before we had planes. And I was there when we sat at the table and talked about what we wanted JetBlue to stand for and who we wanted to be. Bring humanity back to air travel. So during the time that we started, the aviation industry was a mess. Think about it 25 years ago, how you, at one point you wore gloves when you flew in first class, and you know, then we had morphed into People Express and other airlines. And so it was a different type of time then. And we wanted to be driven by a few things, primarily our values. Caring, safety, integrity, passion, and fun. Fun and safety are together because we thought that if you, above all else, you have to be safe every day, but you are at your place of employment for 8 hours a day, and so you also need to have fun. And 25 years ago, we talked about those values. They still line everything that we do and every decision that we make, and we've even put them on a plane. So when we started JetBlue, not only did we want to be the beacon of innovation, but we wanted to put our customers and our crew members at the forefront of everything that we did, right? And so if your crew members don't love where they work, if your customers don't really appreciate what you do, then are you really doing your job well? And so it was important for us to make sure that we included our customers and our crew members in everything that we do. And just think about our jobs, right? We're all in aviation. We are cultural bridges. We bring people together. There are very few industries that can say they do what we do on a daily basis. Nations and cultures and communities, we bring these groups together. But we didn't always celebrate the groups that we were transporting. We didn't always pay homage or respect to the culture and the diversity that we were transporting. And certainly, the leadership teams did not always represent the groups that we were transporting. And for a long time, we've been okay with that, right? It has been okay. Our industry has been the way it has been forever. And for IATA to come out and say, we're going to change this just a little bit, is absolutely incredible. It's incredible because it's going against the norm. And for all of us who have signed on to say this is important, let's give ourselves a round of applause, because the industry is not going to change unless we change it. So let me see what slide I can possibly use here. I talked about our values. So one of the fun things that we do, everybody's doing it now, but we did it early, is painting our planes in ways that kind of show who we are. And this is one of my favorite planes. It's the values plane. It is a plane that not only represents our values, which have been with us from the beginning, but it's a plane that shows a little bit about JetBlue's character, right? And I think the one thing that when we talk about this industry and we talk about how we want to be diverse, integrity, passion, inspiration, these things don't necessarily fuel all the people that work with us, right? And so if we don't have equity in our companies, we surely can't have all of these values. And so it's important for us as a company to really go forward and make sure that we live these values every day. But when we talk about JetBlue and the things that we try to do well, the values and others, well, that's not even mine. There's an other side to the tapestry, right? So if we are the cultural connectors, we have to be honest about the bias that that brings. So we all have bias. We all have those stereotypes and things that we believe. We might not even say them out loud, but we all have them. And when we talk about DEI and the intersection of aviation and DEI, are we actively addressing all of the things that happen to ensure that diversity isn't just a concept or it isn't just a cute term? How do we make sure it's lived reality from the flight deck to the break room? We talked about pilots and the lack of gender equality in the flight deck. We talked about, we can keep that one up. I'll get to it eventually. What happened? Okay. So let's see what's here. Look at this. They're there. That's the connecting part I was talking about. We're connecting people. That's us connecting people. And then when I talk about words, there are some buzzwords around diversity, equity, and inclusion, right? And are we willing to put statistics around that? Are we willing to measure those things? Are we really willing to talk about respect and welcoming and affirming at a place of employment? Is that okay? It is okay, because it hasn't been done. And us in this room have decided that this is important, and we're going to do it. It takes a lot of effort to make sure that everybody coming into your organization feels welcomed. It takes a lot of effort to make sure that there is an attitude of belonging. It takes a lot of effort to be accountable to those things that we haven't even talked about in our industry. But I'm happy to say that we are doing it. This group here and others are really working to change our industry. And I think one of the things that we wanted to make sure is that our policies and our brand were reflective of the multicultural workforce that we had, but also all the customers that traveled on us. We realized that we had to do an internal audit, right? And so is fairness one of the words here? Is that happening across the industry or across all departments? We realized that we needed to embed DEI in the fabric of how we do business. And so we don't want this movement that we're currently pushing forward to be a buzzword. And we certainly, you all are killing me. And we certainly don't want it to be just something that we don't talk about often. But we want DEI to be a business imperative, right? We want it to be important in the work that we do. We want to create an environment where everyone is heard. And so one of the things in aviation for us to consider, being a cultural connector, is how do we move DEI from a social responsibility to a business imperative? And I ask all of you that. How do you move DEI from a social construct to a business imperative? Because we know that customers like diverse companies. We know that the next generation that we're going to hire is going to sit at an interview and ask you about your DEI policy and your social, how you spend your social capital. We know that these things are important to people. We just heard a presentation about menopause. So you know that this is changing, right? And in order for us to ensure that we are taking this seriously, but that this is not a fad, we have to make sure it's a business construct. And to truly recognize DEI as a business imperative, we have to move beyond some of these buzzwords. 2020 in America, DEI became the fad, right? It was a corporate trend. And it was driven by a heightened social unrest. But it was so tightly wound in allyship and belonging, and companies took up the mantle without really understanding what they were doing. What are we talking about here? And so they built DEI structures and then didn't undergird them with the strength and the budgets and the staff that they needed to be successful. I'm not saying that happened over here. I'm saying that definitely happened in the United States. But fast forward to today, and people are questioning the value of DEI. And I know in the United States, DEI is under attack. People are challenging DEI metrics. They are suing companies left and right. Companies are scared to even talk about the work that they're doing. And if it's not a business imperative, then it can easily go away. And so we're working too hard, in my opinion, with initiatives like 25 by 25, to let this all go for naught. We have to make sure that we're making this part of the business imperative. And we have to make sure that we all understand the importance of DEI. And so examining our existing procedures, asking how we could enhance and expand the efforts to do more, these are things that we have to do on a daily basis. And if nothing else, remember that you're doing it for the employees, the ones who feel marginalized when they come to work, the ones who feel unseen or unheard. That's what we do it for. Or the customer that we decide we can treat anyway, maybe because of the way where they're flying. The ramp person and the pilot should feel like they have an equal voice at our companies. The person who cleans the plane and the person who flies the plane should never feel treated differently. We know they make different salaries, but they should feel equally as important. Our industry has a unique opportunity to change the way we do business. And so we said, if we're going to be the intersection of culture and policy change, then we have to bring some of it out to our customers. Our customers need to feel and see the things that we're doing. We can't do things under the rock, behind the, in the back of the closet, under the sheets. We have to bring it out to our customers. And so we do activations in our terminals quite often. We do parades and show who we are and what we stand for. The picture on the bottom is a Bollywood dance. If you look very closely and squint, maybe you could see me in the back. I was hiding because I wasn't very good. But it was in the terminal, and it was fun. But our customers did it with us, those who could and those who didn't know how to do it. The top picture is a activation we did for Trinidad during Carnival. And we took some pictures, and our crew members that are from the Caribbean were so proud, and it became viral. It is, to date, one of the most viewed and shared pieces of social media that we've done. Not paid for, not constructed, not overly architectured. It was just a day, and it was great. And these are the things that we're going to have to do to continue to show cultural relevance, not only to our crew members, but to our customers. And so we celebrate Heritage Month at JetBlue. And when you're on board the airplane, you'll see curated films that align with the Culture Month. The music that plays in the terminal has been selected by our employees crew members. And the music that you hear in the terminal during these Cultural Heritage Months have been selected by our crew member resource groups. And on any given day, you could see one of these activations in the terminal. Some, they're slight. I mean, some you might not notice, like the music in the terminal. You might not pay attention to the movies. But if you're in the terminal, you'll definitely see the activations. Bringing culture to the forefront, that's really important. But then we talk about policies, right? And so how do we address some of the policies and the changes that we need to make? And I'm not saying that we were first. We definitely were not. But our uniform policy changes have meant the world to our crew members. We degendered our uniform policy. You have to wear your uniform properly. We don't care who wears what piece. You can't make up how you wear it, but you can wear the piece that you feel most comfortable in. That was a really hard sell. How many here that work for an airline or a handling company have degendered their uniform policy? Air Canada, stand up, yay. Anybody else? I know British Airways did it pretty early, and other airlines. We weren't first, but we took a lot of pride in making sure that we got it done. And boy, did our crew members speak to us. And there was such fear. Oh my gosh, who's gonna come in wearing this and that, and what will our customers say? Our customers haven't said anything. They are appreciative of the expression, of the freedom of expression that our crew members have. Every single day, they can come to work and show up like their actual selves. And they don't need permission, because we gave them an opportunity to do it. And nobody did anything crazy. For those of you who are familiar with JetBlue, our former CEO, Robert Hayes, was from British Airways. And so he was a little conservative. And he brought me into the office. He said, "Isima, if I see something crazy," I'm like, "Call me. If you see something crazy, call me. I promise. I'll take care of it." He was a little concerned. We didn't see anything crazy because we let people show up as their authentic selves. And this picture brings me so much joy because our crew members, as you can see, have so much joy in the picture. And then when we talk about the intersection of what we need to do from a cultural standpoint and diversity, equity, inclusion, you can't just have it inside your organization, in my opinion. So how are you bringing that expression of diversity, equity, inclusion, belonging to your communities? And the way we do it is we let our crew members volunteer where they're passionate. Where you're passionate is where you'll do your best work. And so these are just examples of our crew members being out in the community, in different communities, diverse communities, doing good. This picture shows our partnership with the Red Sox. And every year we go, we take Red Sox down to the Dominican Republic. And not only do they host baseball camps, but they also build a house for a family in need in one of the outlying communities. We know that being diverse means that there are different needs within our customer base. And if we don't address those, then are we really being true to what we're saying we're doing, right? Diversity, equity, and inclusion is an internal force that we're bringing external. And letting our crew members participate in activities that are near and dear to their heart has shown and proven to be so positive for our organization. In fact, before COVID, and I know COVID was such a long time ago, but before COVID, our 22,000 crew members logged almost 180,000 volunteer hours, logged and verified, because we let them do what they were passionate about. Once again, bringing those cultural identities together to do things that are important in their communities. And we've done that for quite a while. We have a program called Flights for 50. So for every 50 hours that you volunteer, you get 2 Positive Space round-trip tickets to donate to the charity of your choice. We don't have the budget to do a financial match, but that program literally has gotten our brands out in neighborhoods that we would never have thought to communicate with. Why? Because our crew members are passionate about it, and some of these small organizations, it's the largest donation they get all year. So last but not least, we've talked so much, well, maybe not last, but we've talked so much about the intersection of gender and our industry. And we sponsor a program called Fly Like a Girl. We do it at least once a year, where we expose young girls, 8 to 14, to our industry, the industry that we love. And we don't expose them in a way that is chalk and talk. We bring them to the airport, we bring them to a hangar, we open up the engine of a plane, we have a pilot, and we talk to them about real jobs in our industry. We'll be hosting one in Boston, 200 girls, and everybody that speaks to them for the Fly Like a Girl program is a female. Every single person, whether it's a pilot or an engineer, a mechanic, everybody that speaks to them is a female. And that program has, bless you, that program has yielded such positive results for us. We have had, and most recently, a young woman named Stephanie, who's actually doing a video for us today, met a young pilot named Kim. Kim McCollins is our first black female captain. And she was talking to a group called Tools and Tiaras. And Stephanie was so moved by that, she has just gotten her pilot's license. And so that's one person, but if we each got one person once a year, how could we change our industry? How could we change what our flight deck looks like? How could we change the trajectory of our industry? So I implore each of you to find an initiative that helps move the needle for social change and helps make people, both from an ethnic and a racial standpoint and a gender standpoint, realize that this industry can be welcoming and is for everybody. And so that's the one we started with because it was out of order. But I just want to say that we have moved the needle just a little bit, ever so slightly, in the area of gender. And that's because of the work that we're doing collectively. But our work is not done. We have a lot more to do. And we can take a victory lap, just one, but we have to get back to work. And so I am excited to be in the trenches with you making this work happen. I'm excited about changing our industry, and I'm really, really excited about the next generation of aviators. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Aisima. This was very inspiring. So actually, you can stay on stage with us. We'll invite all the speakers from this session, Adrienne, Rachel, Adel, to come back on stage. So Thank you all for your great insights. Is there any questions from the room to one of our presenters? Yes.
Hello, Jana from Volotea. This question is for Aijima. I would like to know if in JetBlue you have affinity groups or communities regarding diversity and inclusion, and how you work with them.
Sure. So we have affinity groups. Our first group was Jet Pride. So let me take a deep breath and make sure I don't leave anybody out. Jet Pride, Blue Aviations, JADE, which is a JetBlue African Diaspora Experience, SAGE, which is the South American Diversity Experience, JetBlue Experience. We have Blue Abilities and Women in Flight and Vets in Blue. And so we work with, my team works with all of them. They have business meetings once a month, and at the beginning of the year, we do a session that helps them plan for the year. And planning for the year for them includes making sure that they focus on the business, commerce, that they focus on education, that they focus on community. And so each of them has what we call a signature event, which is an event that they develop that is the one main big hoopla event for the year. But those groups activate quite often in the terminal and help us, from a cultural standpoint, share the richness and diversity of JetBlue. They're the ones that help with curating movies and for the cultural months and make sure that they, or the heritage months, and make sure that those movies are on board the aircraft, and they do the some of the music that goes into the terminal. So and if there is a crisis in the country, we lean very heavily on them to help understand how we can rectify that crisis, or how we should proceed, or how they want their voice to be heard. And so we're hoping to have a few more CRGs, we call them CRGs, come on board. But we are really proud of the work that they do and how they help us, from a business standpoint, really navigate through tough times, and how they help us celebrate during good times.
Amazing, thank you.
Thank you so much, Aisima. So is there any other questions from the room? Someone in here?
I hate to do this, but I'm gonna ask Aisima something again about JetBlue.
Yes, ma'am.
You've done so much at JetBlue. How do you keep that passion and top it the next time?
I think it's twofold. One is, for me, I love the work that I do. I think that our crew members do so much with so little that, you know, we continue to pour into them from a education standpoint, from a development standpoint. We're now working with some reviews, our review committee, so that some of the work that the crew members are doing, which is volunteer, can be used towards their overall annual reviews. And so the passion that I have is that they continue to show up every day and want to do good work, and I have to show up for them. And then the results. When we have we poll our crew members every year, and the crew members who are either part of our CSR liaisons, corporate social responsibility liaisons, or part of our crew member resource groups, scored about 21% higher in engagement than the rest of the crew members. And so we are pouring into them, and they pour back into the company. And so that's one of the ways that I stay passionate every day about the work that we do. We see the results. They're measurable, and we can talk about them. And it gives me great pride to represent these teams because they do such great work.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Christiana. I'm from Air Canada. And I have a question also for Aisima. I understand that JetBlue is unionized, and I was just wondering if you can elaborate on your collaboration with the unions around DE&I. I've found at Air Canada that they've been tremendously supportive, but I just wanted to see what it was like at other airlines.
So our crew members are some are unionized and some aren't. So our pilots, of course, are unionized. They went first. Our flight attendants or in-flight crew members are now unionized. However, our airport crew members, our tech op crew members, our system op crew members are still have a direct relationship. Thus far, we've had okay conversations with the union. They haven't really been a guiding force one way or another. I think one of the things that's been very helpful is that they came and found a lot of the things that we're doing there, and so some of those things they haven't really bothered with. Our pilots are so active in our ACE camps or other things that we do, and they've allowed them to continue along that path, and they have been very vocal in wanting to help us succeed on the journey for diversity, equity, inclusion. The in-flight union we haven't worked much with at all. I know that they're continuing to have dialogue around different things, and so we haven't had a lot of interface with them. We're looking forward to it, and hopefully they'll let us continue to do the work without any problems. But we do recognize that that's something that we have to be aware of because there are work rules around the stuff that they're doing. So we're conscious of it, and are always willing to have open-door conversations about the work that they do versus the goals that we have.
Thank you very much. Is there any final questions for Aisima? No? Well, thank you very much. Thank you to all
you
the presenters.
Ambassadors at Travelport, and I'm just curious to understand how do you have your ambassadors helping you with your strategy, you know, achieving all your goals, and this is for everyone who can, use examples from your own companies. If you have, I'm assuming you do have ambassadors.
We've had really interesting, I think some of our airlines have put in place ambassador programs, others have got employee resource groups, and it's through that communities that we get the kind of the voice, if you like, of that community to share with us the experiences and challenges that they've faced. I think we've had mixed success with the ambassadors. I think it puts a lot on individuals to be, you know, promoting and representing their community on their own in that particular area. So I think we've found more success with the broader resource groups.
Can I pitch in on that as well? Thank you. Just in terms of ambassadors, your people are going to talk about you. So just be used to that, okay? And for us as a business, we tried to protect it and say, no, you know, it's our brand, it's our this, it's our that, we'll control it. You can't. So if you treat your people well, they'll promote your business well. Mm. So that's ultimately what we're all about today. And that's what we should continue to do. And just let them promote you. Be okay with that. Manage. We were talking earlier about managing the 95% and not the 5%. And that's what we do. We manage the 5%. So I was using an analogy earlier around coat hangers. Now bear with me. So, the reason you can't take coat hangers off normally in an airport, in a hotel, is because 5% of guests stole them. So now they're fixed. And that's how we manage people. We manage to the 5%. So if we're constantly bombarding with disciplinaries and policy and, you know, rules and restrictions and don't post and social media and all of this, you're going to get poor culture, poor ambassadors. Mm-hmm. If you work to the 95%, they're going to do all the promotion you need. As you said, one of your best posts was your people on social media. Mm. So we're just getting around that mindset in the boardroom of just loving them and letting them get on with it.
Mm. And I will love to add that I think one of the things about having people promote on your behalf is that they have to understand the goal. And so if you do it in the office and don't share what you're trying to achieve, then it's hard for people to promote that. So I think making sure that everybody's clear about what the objectives are, even if they're short-term objectives. this year we're going to focus on X. Then everybody can line up and march in that the same direction, and that's really important.
Thank you very much to the both of you for your insight and great presentation. Thank you so much. Thank you for your questions. So now we're going to serve coffee outside. So we will be back in about 20 to 25 minutes, I would say. So yes, enjoy the break, and we'll see you in 20 minutes. Thank you.